many of you guys have been to Alpine? We're a small college in a small place in the middle of nowhere, and we're very proud of being in the middle of nowhere. And we see ourselves as protectors of the Big Bend. And in our little towns there, Fort Davis, Marfa, Marathon, Alpine, are gems. Although in Alpine itself, a number of the stores are in remnants of old gas stations, they're all beautiful towns, or beautiful stores. And it's a very nice community, really a strong sense of community in these little towns. I'm from Detroit, big city. I've never met friendlier people. We don't lock our doors, I shouldn't tell you that, but we don't lock our doors at night.
You trust us.
We feel that we're very fortunate. Right now, coming through Alpine is the Trans-Pecos pipeline, a 42-inch pipeline, bigger than the Keystone pipeline, that will propel highly volatile natural gas at high velocity through Big Bend into Mexico, where they will build a liquefied natural gas terminal to ship gas to Asia. It's going just about 1,000 feet from where I live. It goes right through town. And we fought very hard against this. This is what it's like to live in Alpine right now. The pipes are coming through. We fought against this for the last year or so. Joey's done a little research on it in his journalism class. So this is what life is like there. And these are my students from my class in environmental literature. We're going to talk about Barry's writing, and we're going to talk about Linda Hogan some other writers that we've read. Let me introduce our first speaker, who recorded her presentation as a YouTube video. This is Shannon Darr, and she's speaking on spiritual and environmental roots in Linda Hogan's dwellings. Let me say a few words about her. Shannon is a senior, she will graduate on her birthday, May 14th, with her Bachelor of Arts degree. She's a fiction writer and has completed the first draft of her novel. When she isn't in school, working at the school library and writing stories, she's watching British television shows, painting, and posting book reviews on YouTube. So here's Shannon.
I'm not sure exactly how loud we're getting.
The progress that I made on my paper, Spiritual Roots of the Environment in Linda Hogan's Dwellings. It's not finished she woke up and obeyed the voice in her dream. And she says, this is what happened. This is an actual true account of what happened. I had a dream, and this happened. And she uses that to show kind of how there is something more out there than just the physical world, that there is some guiding force behind everything. Blonde Batek, and I apologize if I butcher any names. I try to pronounce them correctly, but sometimes I fail miserably. But Blonde Batek said in her article, Native North American Religions and Participatory Visions, remarks that Indian religions, because of their overarching emphasis on individual visionary experiences, are mythical at the core. And she says this when she explains the ethos behind the collective Native American religions as a whole. Linda Hogan continues on and says, others have tried for centuries to understand the world by science and intellect, but have not yet done so. Which means there's more to this world, basically, than just what we see, hear, feel, and touch through our five senses, basically. And then Baltek continues on to write that Indians have encouraged the seeking of visions and dreams through various practices and beliefs. For Linda Hogan and others, these visions and dreams lend a hand in seeing further into what binds the physical world together into a cohesive working pattern of life. Basically, there's more to life, and that we all are connected through something, but what it is, we do not know, and we won't be able to find out what it is that connects us through the physical world. Ceremony and rituals are important in reconnecting with one's spirituality, especially with the vast spiritual realm that connects every living thing. The ceremony that is depicted in detail in her chapter, All My Relations, illustrates the importance of rituals as follows. The ceremony itself includes not just our own prayers and stories of what brought us to it, but also includes the unspoken records of history, the mythic past, and all other lives connected to ours, our families, nations, and other creatures. And then she goes on to explain her ceremony with one, the meeting with the elder, giving an offering to the elder, and then explaining the reason for needing his spiritual guidance. Then she goes and prepares the ritual as the elder of her own household, basically. And then she and others get together for this ritual, and then the ceremony ends, and everybody leaves. And when I say end, she believes that the ceremony, the completing of the ceremony, is actually the beginning. The ceremony continues in the way you live your life. In an interview with Joseph Burchak, Linda Hogan remarks that she feels very fortunate that I have a place to live where I am grounded, surrounded really by earth, the circle of mountains. The balance you mentioned between the spiritual, the physical, and the mental, a lot of people who become interested in the spiritual tradition become very silly. They go off so far, there's no balance of no footing or no fitting, and our feet are very important in spiritual life, touching earth. Basically, she's saying, while we need to be spiritual, we also need to be grounded in reality, which that is, I think, all of us can agree on that. We have to be grounded in reality in order to gain a better understanding of the reality around us. Hogan explains that it is part of a healing and restoration ceremony. It is the mending of a broken connection between us and the rest. For Hogan, ceremony and ritual provides a mending, a reconnection of the person to the people, places, and things around them. Humanity in this modern world has consistently rejected their place in this world as part of a harmonious whole. And I believe that is our biggest problem as humanity, is we aren't trying to work in a harmonious whole. We're fighting each other. We're fighting against each other, trying to worry with each other. Even if we have different opinions and beliefs and practices, what we shouldn't be doing is going up to each other and saying, we should body, and it's essential to sharing an intimate connection with the environment. She uses these stories of creations, and her chapter creations, to prove that many of us in this time have lost their inner substance, the inner substance of our lives, and have forgotten to give praise and remember the sacredness of all life. At the beginning of the chapter, Hogan uses a Mayan creation myth to help illustrate her point on the importance of roots for both individual human beings and civilizations as a whole. It is these roots that will help us remember our place in the environment. She uses the Mayan creation count, this account, excuse me, to, or one of the versions she mentions, to conclude that emptiness and estrangement are deep wounds strongly felt in the present time. Julie Yant writes that Hogan seems sad about, sometimes even resigned to, the declining value of spirituality and ecology and of American Indian rights. Dave Afendilian notes in the introductory paragraph of his article, What Other Americans Can and Cannot Learn from Native American Environmental Ethics, that since the 1960s, many Americans have experienced a sense of acute moral crisis, both in terms of our spirituality and our relations to the environment. Our estrangement from the environment has affected the American culture with this disconnect. The silent, critical observer sees teachers quick to label children with disabilities as stupid or below average, when in reality these students are beyond brilliant, but think a different pattern of thought than the average person does. The divorce rate, while declining, is as high as is the amount of children born outside of wedlock to single parents. And I believe all of this could very well be a reflection of what Linda Hogan observed just within the borders of the United States, that humanity is lacking something, we are lacking a spiritual connection to the world around us. We have neglected our spirituality, and because we've neglected our spirituality, we've begun to not care about life. And I completely agree with her, because I see it too. I see it too, and she and I have different worldviews, completely different worldviews, but she's right, I believe. She's completely right, and this is why. Linda Hogan's references to myth, ceremony, and spirituality reveals the nature of and the necessity of connecting to the world around us on a spiritual level and how it is just as important as the physical observation and care. And we need to recognize that there are unexplained forces at work in the world and see that such a recognition will not harm the masses. Should humanity acquiesce to a spiritual connection to themselves, the creator, and the creation, then maybe the damage humanity has done to themselves and the environment can be repaired, and we no longer neglect the earth. Anyway, so that is the end of my presentation and the gist of what I'm writing, of where my research is going. Up next is Alexandra Ruiz, and she is an undergraduate student at Sowell State University. She plans to graduate with an English major from Sowell State University. She's from El Paso, Texas, born and raised. She loves the color gray and loves a TV show called Grey's Anatomy by Shonda Rhimes. Have a good day.
night, they call upon the stars in the darkness. They call upon the hot breezes. They call upon the heat coming off the earth. They implore all the animals. They implore the ones that fly in the sky, the ones that crawl upon the earth, the ones that walk, the ones that swim in the water, and the ones that move in between water, sky, and earth. They implore them to focus on the moisture. They all are dependent from the dark dryness of the earth, of the desert. On that one night, the call of the people is heard. It is heard by the oceans, the winds, and clouds. All respond sympathetically. Throughout the night, you hear the ones who is assigned yelling. And then it continues with bottom language. Before it becomes light, and then bottom language, there are still songs to be sung. Before the sun comes up, there is still a little bit of night left. With the dawn, we face the sunrise. We face it with all our humility. We are mere beings. All we can do is extend our hands towards the first light. Our hands, we capture the first light. We take it and cleanse ourselves. We touch our eyes with it. We touch our faces with it. We touch our hair with it. We touch our limbs. We rub our hands together. We want to keep the light with us. We are complete with the light. This is the way we begin and end things. That is Oyam Dances by Ofeila Zapeda. I will be reading some small phrases from my own essay, what I think about the poem itself. The poetry is a ritual. Comes with the concept of energy combining together as one in order for the rain to come, a ceremonial concept in which the purity of all good energy comes together as one single great power, in which they're calling the rain and asking for help for the animals in the land. It is a contribution for all the animals in the earth as equal individuals. So I'm asking y'all, what is rain for you? Can anybody tell me what rain?
Mercy.
Mercy? Okay.
The smell in the air 2 nights ago.
To the Odom people, it represents dependence. As the poem reads, quote, all are dependent from the dark dryness of the desert. As well as the Odom people do not stop dancing all night until the sun comes up. To myself, rain represents happiness when the first drop of water hits my face. At first, I know it's going to rain, yet it takes me by surprise. In a spare moment, my face goes from normal to flinching to happiness, feeling a single raindrop falling in my face. It's a magical experience every time it rains, and I feel a different experience. To me, that is rain. I got this picture, for example, from Michael Chiego, and this is what a rain dance for the Oran people look like. And they're chanting. Their basket. We're blindsided. As humans, we bypass this world with blind eyes. We realize that it is around us. We notice the reality of our surroundings. Then we comprehend what the environment has for us. Yet more importantly, we can commune with the environment because it speaks to us as long as we listen. We have to have our ears open and hear what our surroundings trying to tell us, then we cannot understand why we're here. The poem speaks from the Odom people to the earth, in which shows the value that earth has in their life, the magnificent ways of the Odom people, in which the dance rain is perfect example of earth and mankind becoming whole, each symbiosis to each other, as a beautiful connection linking ways ways as umbilical cords, an umbilical cord, each child with its mother. Quote, they implore all the animals, the ones that fly in the sky, the ones that crawl upon the earth, the ones that walk, the ones that swim in the water, and the ones that move in between water, sky, and earth. They implore them to focus on the moisture. All are dependent from the dark dryness of the earth. And that one night, they call the people, it is heard. It is heard by the ocean, winds, and clouds. All respond sympathetically. I'm sorry. Everybody has a different language. Everybody, we go around and we might meet someone and we do not speak their language. These are the words that start at the beginning of the poem. This starts at the beginning of the poem and then we talk in English and then the chant continues. Ofeila's Zapeda poetry is a poem that represents her language throughout a song. A chant, a quite rhythmic chant. As you see the words, each one at a time, one can see the beauty of the chant that is being welcomed by the earth. Ofeila Zapeda starts her poem with Native American words, which I do not understand. I tried to look for them, yet I came out empty-handed because of the lack of translation. For example, I try looking for them in English to translate in order to understand the poem in deeper meaning. Except there are no specific places where I can go on the internet to type these words and translate. Unlike other languages such as Spanish, French, German, this language is a beautiful language, yet we cannot comprehend what it means if we cannot translate it. This is devastating in many ways because we cannot interpret what's being said. Secondly, the language barrier is different. Lastly, it's resuscitated culture. The mystery of this language adds to the beauty of the world, the beauty of a new world that someone will understand until they come across two colliding worlds, making an effort to understand one another. The Odum language is, even though it's not translated, the words signify the presence of Odum people and their ancestors. It's well given as a path in which it gives the reader, to feel it deeply the song that is being sung throughout the poetry. As you hear the song in the poem, you can feel peace and ease as if the rhythm hits your bones to the core. It is a beautiful sense, Odum people. Odum language is not universal, yet your body understands the words that are spoken in the earth by its people. Thank you. Up next, the next speaker that's coming up would be Joy Chavez. He is currently a sophomore at Sowell State University, majoring in English. Joy is a native to Alpine, Texas, but plans to pursue his graduate career elsewhere after he achieves his bachelor degree. Joy hopes to find a suitable career with his English degree and is curious about all different types of literature. Thank you.
Hello. First of all, I'd like to say it's a privilege to be here talking to all you guys. It's really cool. It's really been wonderful to hear all the ideas. It's really been awesome. So today I'm going to be talking to you about technology and being and the effect it has on us as people. And whenever you hear technology, immediately you start thinking about maybe this big TV up here, or your phone, or your laptop. Although those are small concerns, it's not necessarily the bigger concern that I'm talking about. because after all, I love technology. There's no doubt to that. However, I feel like there's a point where it becomes too much, where we become too dependent on it. We can't necessarily prosper because we look it up on Google or, you know, something like that. We're not learning. We're learning through words of someone else, and it might be a right way to do it, but is it necessarily the correct way to do it? We don't know. We just go off of what other people say. That's mostly what I'm going to be talking about, is the dependence that technology has created for all of us. This dependence that we need it. Like, our minds have become so deteriorated as far as newer technology. I was telling my classmates yesterday, like, for me, I play video games. I play a video game, I'm already bored, I want another one, you know? And it's horrible to say, but it happens amongst all of us. We get so bored with just one thing, we want something new. And eventually, the newer thing will become something more destructive than it already has become. So, what I'm mainly focusing on is this book right here, written by Edward Abbey, The Monkey Wrench Game. And like Dr. Francis mentioned about the pipeline going through Alpine, I was born and raised in Alpine. And as a kid, I guess I kind of took advantage of how clean our water was, how clean our air was, the environment, how green it was, everyone recycles. And just in the years, you know, at being in college after high school, I've noticed already so many trucks, people coming through. It's like, you know, who's coming out here to Alpine, you know? But all these people and all these trucks, pipelines, and so are coming through, and it's just, for me, I've been born there, it's easy for me to see. Maybe not so much the college students, but it's easier for me to say. So, with that said, the dams and the pipelines are all ripping through the earth, terrorizing the nature because it is deemed necessary by some government official. There are some points where people fight and fight, like in the case with the pipeline in Alpine, to either change or stop the process of building dams or pipelines, but in reality, there isn't really a single thing they can do. And Edward Abbey captures this desire to seek out injustice within the community. The injustices being, you know, bulldozers plowing through the earth and the massive machinery harvesting all the delicate resources we need in order to survive. Since the project, like Dr. Francis was saying, I interviewed a commissioner of a precinct that covers Brewster County, and Brewster County is very large. And he's really an activist for Alpine. I've known him pretty much my whole life. And to be able to ask him, is the pipeline really coming through? And to just see in his face so much like hopelessness, you know, that at this point it's up to FERC, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, it's literally up to them, their last stand, to say whether it's not. But at this point, it's safe to say it's probably coming. And just to see him so heartbroken, it was really something. Like, he, you know, people might not think in the town that the commissioner's doing anything to prevent it from happening, but in reality, he's doing everything he can. But this goes back to the concern of government officials and private corporations that buy these pieces of land, and they don't understand. I grew up there, you know. The one thing that is in their mind is money. That is always the main thing. So it's easier for them to just say, you know, this is going to be a job for me. It's going to be something I can, you know, make some money on. Why not? You know, I'm not really harming anything. In their mindset, that might be true. They might be, you know, making some money and then be able to support their family. How are we to say that they're doing something wrong, right? Well, these are the, quote, megalomaniacal mega machines that Abby wants us to essentially destroy. This is Edward Abbey. He and his novel, Monkey Wrench Game, he showcases the perspectives of four individuals who want to save the land that they know and love. Complete strangers, they all meet at one time, they all, you know, start to realize that they care so much for the land that they need to do something about it. And like I said earlier, before I go on any further, I would like to first point out that I am also a part of the problem concerning technology and dependency. I just want to clarify that with you so that you understand that I'm against these, so to speak, false gods that we spend so much time and money building, when in reality, at one point when we're all gone, they'll still be there sustaining the life that it was made for, which will be no life at all. So I am against them ripping through our earth for the nourishment and monetary contentment of men in governments, but although I am against it, I am still a part of it. Martin Heidegger, the founder of phenomenology, mentions this ideal in his article, The Question Concerning Technology. In this article, he refers to the process of being involved in something without necessarily wanting to be as a standing reserve. This is his quotes. The word expresses something more and essential than mere stock. The word standing reserve assumes the rank of an inclusive rubric. This shows how some people do not particularly want to be involved, yet they are essentially on a smaller scale. Quote, the forester is ordered by the industry that produces commercial woods, whether he knows it or not. End quote. I thought this idea was fascinating because not only am I a perfect example of a standing reserve for technology, but it amazes me to think that there are tons of people out there doing what they have to survive. For example, the oil field workers who want to bathe in the black liquid gold, they can't necessarily be blamed for the destruction of our planet because who can really turn down all that money to begin with? The same goes for the dam workers back in the 1930s who jumped to the opportunity to be able to have a job to raise their families. They weren't all teaming up to create, you know, global destruction. They saw an opportunity to keep themselves surviving, and they took it. The main concern, like I said earlier, is how governments around the world harvest these resources, then essentially they start up a game of go fish, you know. You got some oil over there or something, you know. So these things happen behind our eyes that we don't even know what's going on, and it's happening all the time, you know, trading oil, gas, water, and these are up to government officials because they're doing it for the greater good, right? So how does this all tie in with technology? And it's probably what you're all wondering. Abbey's literature and sarcasm in his novel paints a clear picture of how gullible and dependent our society has become on things like power plants, dams, pipelines, and factories. Technology on all levels is slowly deteriorating our will to act against projects like these and ultimately resulting in our downfall. We are already at the level where we put all of our information and trust into our smartphones, like they're our best friends, without even considering the fact that hacking is alive and well nowadays. Somebody could easily just all your credit card numbers, phone numbers, everything, and in an instant you look at your bank account, you don't have nothing. That happens, and it's happening more often. So, but how can we fight back? You know, how are we supposed to go without technology? The hard truth is at this point, if you aren't adapting to technology, you're not logically evolving. It's getting to the point where you have to understand it, because later on, if you don't understand any of that, you're not necessarily gonna maybe get a job someplace that somebody, you know, went to IT school or something, he knows all about this, you know. One simple idea behind my research is if technology did not exist, the world around us would be so touching and there really wouldn't be any words to describe it. We'd just be endured in this world of beautifulness. This idea is what drives the minds of the four nature lovers in Abbey's novel. The idea to preserve the nature and beauty around them bonds them together like brother and sister. And going back to Heidegger, in the same article, he mentions, quote, the evil behind technology, end quote. In his argument about technology, he states, quote, the essence of technology as a destiny of revealing is the danger. When I first read that, I had to read it, I don't know how many times to understand it. But what he's saying is, we're all essentially a part of technology. We all create it, we all use it. The only real danger behind it, obviously, because it's not alive, is our will to surpass one another in competition rather than teamwork. We want to create something that's going to be better so we make more money, and more people buy it, rather than just creating something that will benefit more people rather than a certain people. That idea is lost in America. It's all about competition now. It's all about money, and it's really depressing. Abby and Monkey Wrench Gang creates a story that shows the four beings that want to make a change, even if it means breaking the law. Because during the story, they're destroying bulldozers, vandalizing things, things that are against the law. And it's ironic that these characters who are vandalizing and destroying government property are the heroes of the novel. We view them as heroes because we want to endure the adventure that they all get to endure while simultaneously protecting what we love. And the truth is, technology is on a racehorse, and that racehorse is a mile ahead of us. We are at the point where we have to keep up with it, or it will leave us behind in the dust. And that is the very same reason we should not let it get too far ahead of us in terms of creation and distribution. At some point, and who knows when it will be, we will run out of gas, we will run out of oil, and the wars that we fight over now for those resources won't compare to the ones later on. At that point, there'll be almost extinct resources, and I mean, just watching something like a survival video or film or something, how people will literally kill each other for water. I mean, it's not insane to think later on in the future we're already killing each other for oil. So, with that said, this is Hey Dude doing a very heroic action here. I'm going to end the my presentation with a quote from Edward Abbey. And it's pretty lengthy, but he literally covers everything that I've just said. Quote, "All this fantastic effort, giant machines, road networks, strip mines, conveyor belt, pipelines, slurry lines, loading towers, railway and electric train, $100 million coal-burning power plants, 10,000 miles of high-tension towers and high-voltage power lines, the devastation of the landscape, the destruction of Indian homes and Indian grazing lands, Indian shrines and Indian burial grounds, the poisoning of the last big clean air reservoir in the 48 contiguous United States, the exhaustion of precious water supplies, all that ball-breaking labor and all that back-breaking expense and all that heartbreaking insult to land and sky and human heart, for what? All that for what? Why? To light the lamps of Phoenix, suburbs not yet built, to run the air conditioners of San Diego and Los Angeles, to illuminate shopping centers, parking lots at 2 in the morning, to power aluminum plants, magnesium plants, vinyl chloride factories, and copper smelters, to charge the new tubing that makes the meaning, all the meaning there is, of Las Vegas, Albuquerque, Tucson, Salt Lake City, the amalgamated metropolis of Southern California, to keep alive the phosphorescent, putrefying glory, all the glory there is left, called downtown, nighttime, wonderful USA." Thank you guys so much for listening to my thoughts and my presentation. It's been really awesome coming here and hearing all of your ideas, so thank you so much. So Timmy's next. Okay, so next we have Timmy, Timilehin, Alaka, and he's an English graduate student at Sowell, just like we are. Timilehin is an international student from Nigeria, and he is interested in post-colonial theory and working class literature. He graduates this May and hopes to pursue a PhD in English with a focus on social justice and working class literature.
sorry. Cool. Thank you, Joey. good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for having me. I will be talking to you about Linda Hogan's Dwellings. It's a very, very powerful book, and it gave me a new perspective about the dichotomy of old culture and new culture, the modern world versus the old traditional culture, like Mr. Lopez had shown us earlier today. In my bio, my academic interests have probably shown that I'm gravitating towards postcolonial theory, but I must confess I originally did not see its role in the talk I have prepared today. However, I must beg your forgiveness as postcolonial theory has crept into this environmental work anyway. I would say, though, that the correlation between Native American nature writing and postcolonial theory is not so far off. The way I see it is that when the voice of Native American culture, whose sustained existence has been put in a precarious place by colonialism and modern culture, when it resonates so beautifully the way it has in the works of Linda Hogan and Dwellings, we cannot really help but revert to the cataclysmic effects of colonization on these old cultures, as Hogan calls them. She mentions over and over, old cultures, old cultures, old cultures. And I think that's to expand the idea that she doesn't just focus on Native American culture, she focuses on an older way of thinking, maybe the symbolic equity of the round table in the Arthurian legends or something like that. Older cultures that had reverence for spirituality and for nature and for community. So Hogan in Dwellings diagnoses and addresses the devastating effects human decisions have had on nature by reevaluating the place of man within the presence of a sentient earth. Her place and the place of her culture, okay, I wasn't using the mic, I'm sorry. her place and the place of her culture as a displaced and disenfranchised culture becomes equally reflected upon. On writing Manifest Borders by Mike Walter states that for Hogan, there is no difference between the genocide of Native American people and the ongoing destruction of nature. An excerpt from the same article quotes Hogan saying, "What happens to the people and what happens to the land is the same thing." Similarly, the loss of nature's voice lamented in Dwellings echoes the loss of the Native American culture, and the restoration of these voices, however, in a more expansive sense, the restoration of harmonious dwelling of not only the Native American culture, but for all of humanity. That said, in a bid to illustrate what I mean by terrestrial intelligence, I want us to reflect upon Linda Hogan's beautiful poetics in Dwellings. One which a poetics in Dwellings is one that I must confess that I poorly imitate in this work. it doesn't compare in any sense, but I tried my best. The sentence of nature, according to Hogan's poetics, and dwellings is not to be taken as a personification. I've mentioned that nature has a voice, and Hogan as well talks about nature as an alive entity, as a conscious sentient entity. And I want to reiterate that this is not a personification. She means it, that nature can be heard and it speaks. In the preface of Dwellings, she mentioned twice that the natural world is alive and conscious. And to avoid any literary misinterpretations, she adds, and I quote, "These writings search out a world of different knowns. It enters a doorway into the mythical world, a reality known by my ancestors." I put that in caps. A reality known by my ancestors. So the old culture lived this language. They lived this culture. They communed with nature, in not in a mythical sense, but in a real sense. As shown, Hogan informs us that this is a spiritual journey. However, this journey is a reality known by her ancestors. Just to repeat that. The emphasis here is to remind us, the new and young on this continent, as Hogan calls us, who have been swindled off our spiritual consciousness by modernity, that nature indeed speaks to us, perhaps in an old language which we do not understand anymore, or which is rapidly getting away from us. This old form of language is what I try here to present as a terrestrial intelligence. However, before I continue, I have a set of pictures that maybe answer or ask the question, how does nature speak to us? And I just want us to follow the slides, and I wouldn't be discussing them. I just want us to look at them. These pictures as presented, they do not speak. Yet, they speak. And they speak to us in a different way. Not in our language, in the way that we understand. But they do speak to us. But we do not hear them. So it's not in our linguistic construction. It's out of it. And that's what I try to, that's what I want to illuminate as a terrestrial intelligence. I write here that they speak in vocabularies unfound yet in our language repertoire. They are unrestrained by cultural complexities of human linguistics. Hogan and Dwellings pay sustained attention to language as a communicative concept and as a cultural device. Hogan's works, most of her works are focused on repairing the disconnection between man and nature. So the whole idea of an unconventional style language as a mediating device and human modern language as a culturally oppressive device is often represented in her work. In her poem, The Sand Hills, she says that, I quote, "The language of cranes we were once told is the wind." Similarly, end quote. Similarly, in Dwellings, she says on page 26 that bats hear their way through the world. They hear the sound that exists at the edges of our lives. Leaping through blue twilights, they cry out a thin language, then listening for its echoes to return, end quote. These fascinating ways of knowing are the forms of languages humankind does not comprehend or appreciate because we revel in the assumed superiority of our own language. She states that with language, we humans have no way of knowing, and I quote, "Without language, we humans have no way of knowing what lies beneath the surface of one another. And yet, there are communications that take place on a level that goes deeper than our somewhat limited human spoken languages," end quote. By referring to human language as limited, Hogan relates human language to a hindrance or distraction in humankind's quest for harmony with nature. Human language, I would say, is a component of human culture, and we should understand our reservations for this system of language by her necessity to express the sanctity of a sacred culture in the language of her oppressors. So Hogan's distrust for language is not imbibing her subtle language against the oppressor, or for either their language or their culture, or for hers. However, she recognizes human language as a tool which may be too shallow to comprehend the loud whisperings of nature. She says, and I quote, "As one of our Indian elders has said, there are laws beyond our human laws and ways above ours. We have no words for this in our language, or even for our experience of being here, of being there. Ours is a language of commerce and trade, of laws that can be bent in others in order that treaty might be broken, land wounded beyond healing. It is a language that is limited emotionally and spiritually, as if it cannot accommodate such magical strength and power." At the latter stage of this quote, are petitions that exceeded the spiritual inadequacies of human language. The term becomes one with culture, expressing its potentials as a destructive device. For example, post-colonialism comes in again, I'm sorry. Post-colonial theorists have often argued the role of language in constructing the power pyramid, that is, the vertical relationship between races, and how the illusion of a higher race is constructed. Hogan herself mentions in Dwellings that, I quote, "Language usage, in fact, often determines social class order in our societal systems." So in a sense, if we do not want to see it from the perspective of race or colonization, we can think about how language constructs class. Those who speak the same language as us may be discriminated by the fact that they cannot read or write. So that's just an analogy. Thinking about Hogan's quote, which is the one that that sets societal systems and class order, I think about William Shakespeare's The Tempest. And it makes me think about Caliban, who is described as one who gabbled in the most brutish way, in a way to say that he doesn't talk. post-colonial theorists have looked at this piece of literature from several angles, and in fact, we've tried to reposition the place of Caliban as the hero in this play. The inability of Caliban to communicate in European tongue shows us the fact that it relegates his life, because he becomes a slave. And he becomes a lesser human that may be exploited or assaulted. The same, or at least is similar, in the relationship between man and nature. The animosity which builds between the settlers and the native Caliban because of this linguistic discord is reminiscent of the historical pattern of both human-to-human relationship and human-to-nature relationships. Slavery can be viewed as an effect of the former, and climate change as an effect of the latter. Do we therefore assume that the emergent discord between man and nature, which has been dangerously widened by modern civilization, can be related to humankind's insistence to communicate with nature in its own language of convenience? Hogan speaks about Eugene Linden's silent partner in a book which she says reports on a series of language experiments on primates, and another by Harry Hallow, which she partly describes as torturous, the processes of the experiments described as torturous experiments. Her conclusions on this experiment, she says, shows that the question raised throughout this project were primarily questions about ourselves, our own morality, our own way of being in the world, and our responsibilities of caretaking of the earth. Humankind in its deep yearnings to know nature, to seek answers of itself from nature, has once again been compromised by its language of dominance. Hogan says, we, and I quote, "We have feelings that can't be spoken. The very speechlessness results in poems that try to articulate what can't be said directly, in paintings that bypass the intellectual boundaries of our daily vision, and in music that goes straight to the body. And there is even more deep language in us," end quote. As I draw to a close, it seems for Hogan that the value in finding nature's voice is to mute our own voice. We may look to Humboldt or Thoreau, their journeys into the wilderness, where speech is of no use, as as a demonstration of seeking this muting of our own voice and letting nature speak. However, the fact that they draw away from human speech, because obviously you cannot go in there and talk to trees or animals with your words, with human linguistic, that is the most important part of this pilgrimage, of this journey into the wilderness. It's to silence us. And it, Hogan even sees she sees a little bit of flow into this journeys into the wilderness. And she says that I quote, "The wilderness is seen as having value only as it enhances and serves our human lives, our human world. While most of us agree that the wilderness is necessary to our spiritual and psychological well-being, it is a container of far more. So the wilderness offers us more than just going there to heal ourselves. It also has its own components, and it has its own beauty, and it has its own purpose. And both feeds into itself. So we are part of it, and it is also part of us." The wilderness, as Mrs. Priscilla Ibarra said yesterday, probably lies within us. There is no wilderness in Dallas, but you found it. And thank you for that yesterday, by the way. So I feel like the wilderness is within the stories told, from picking from what you said yesterday. It's within the stories told in these languages of old native cultures, and within the struggles seen and the journeys shared between man, his neighbors, and their host, which is Earth. Finally, as I conclude, I will attempt to define terrestrial intelligence, to go back to the source. I want to say it is a linguistic process. Perhaps a process of unconventional communication which relies on spiritual consciousness and emotive responses, as opposed to the mechanical process of communication by speech. Thank you very much. So, I won't be going yet, I'm sorry. I have a paper by one of our brilliant graduate students as well, and she could not be here for some reasons. She has priorities. So I would be helping her deliver a paper, and just give me a moment while I pull up her work. All right. So this is which life lives, man hunting and the disconnection of life, by Julianna Larrinaga. She is also a graduate student. We both graduate this May, and I don't know much about her, but she is also a very brilliant graduate student, and we work together. All right, so I'll start.
Interested. She's just graduating. These two guys, Julianna and Timmy, are studying right now for the graduate exam, so it's kind of stressful for them. And Tim came out here, but Julianna had to put her nose to the grindstone to study. And that's why she's not here. She studies women's studies, Mexican-American literature, and borderlands literature. And she plans to seek a PhD at the Michigan University.
Okay. So, Julianna starts with a quote from Dwellings as well, and it says, I quote, "I believe people fear their own debts, so they must belittle it. There are lessons to be learned in our behavior," end quote. What causes a fear of debt so deeply embedded that man must take the lives of the ones deemed inferior to him? Lives that cannot speak nor protect themselves from humanity's creation of weaponry and cruelty. Linda Hogan, a Chickasaw poet and novelist, mentions in the quote above from her novel's Dwellings that people belittle death in an attempt to suppress their own fears. By belittling the death of an animal, we magnify our own and distinguish our superiority. But why the death of wolves? She's asking a question. Linda Hogan writes in her novel Dwellings that wolves contain the traits of humans that we try to suppress. We deny the existence of these traits within us because we associate them with evil. We categorize wolves as verminous nuisances, but ultimately we view them as threats. She introduces a quote here by Hogan. The leading cause of death of wolves is contact with the human world. Our presence means tragedy to them, as theirs does to us. Here is an example. Okay, I'm sorry. Barry Lopez, an author specializing. And I just look up and he's right there looking at me. Sorry. Specializing in the relationship between the physical world and human culture, addresses wolf hunting in his book Of Wolves and Men. In this book, he writes of the disassociation between man and wolf. Barry Lopez writes that wolves have traits that humanity yearns to possess. Man is not satisfied with his position in the world. He carries a desire to be fully at one with the capabilities of his body and to be fully at one with his surroundings, like that of a wolf. But what man fails to realize is that by hunting animals in such malice pushes us farther away from becoming what we desire. Barry Lopez writes, "It does not demean men to want to be what they imagine the wolf to be, but it demeans them to kill the animal for it." In Of Wolves and Men, Lopez writes, as man matured, the traditional reason for hunting to obtain food has disappeared, along with the sacred relationship with the hunted. Lopez references Native American culture and how the respect for animal was the same, if not more, as humans. It is said that when Native Americans partook in hunting, they would first ask the animal spirit for permission, then thank them for sacrificing their lives to contribute to the survival of mankind. Wolves, as well as other animals, were viewed as sacred spirits. Now, wolves are hunted for prize. We have labeled them as intimidating, menaces, and no longer necessary to us, therefore making them useless to the rest of the world. What would happen if wolves became extinct? In Dwellings, Linda Hogan writes of the relationship between wolves and birds. Quote, "The birds are companions of the wolves. It is thought that they direct the wolves to their prey. Then stand by until the carcasses is relinquished to them for their own earned share in the feast," end quote. The link between wolf and bird is one example of how the flow of wildlife is dependent on one another. Wolves provide nourishment for other animals leaving behind carcasses for them to eat from. In a newsletter titled "Living with Wolves," writes that wolves play a vital role in the restoration of environments and ecosystems. Wolves target sick old elk and deer, which provides the opportunity for the eldest animals to reproduce. This newsletter also mentions that further help with the ecosystem has been contributed by wolves because of their redistribution of elk herds, which allows vegetation to cover along rivers and streams, which in time is better for many species of fish, mammals, and plant life. Let's fix our mistakes with knowledge. The relationship between Native American and the natural world is a type of relationship that ecologists have been trying to introduce to the modern world in an attempt to save it. In the article, "Probing the Relationship Between Native Americans and Ecology," by Nathan Scherer, says that the purpose of the research is to not see humans as rulers of Earth, but as fellow citizens with all life forms, to see the biosphere as a continually conserved natural order of nutrients cycling through both living and non-living parts of the environment, end quote. He proposes to do this by widespread knowledge. Scherer also writes that in Native American culture, quote, "Central to the idea that hunting is a sacred occupation is the idea that animals, like human beings, are conscious, social, powerful spiritual beings who must be approached in respectful ways. Disrespecting these animals results in an unsuccessful hunt, as well as a poor rapport with the sacred," end quote. Nathan Scherer suggests that through the power of knowledge, man can realize that we are not the sole dominant species. We are equal to our surroundings. We are all mere inhabitants of this huge planet in a giant galaxy. Man is not the ruler of the earth, although through the wolf, man believes we can be. Who holds the power, us or them? Man has removed the animal from being a living, breathing being and morphed them into commodities available at our own disposal. It is this action that has put humanity in a dangerous place. We have forgotten that in the eyes of predators, we are prey ourselves. And as society continues to intrude on unfamiliar territory, we continue to put ourselves in the path of predators. Brett L. Walker's article, "Animals and the Intimacy of History," reflects on some of Barry Lopez's writings. Barry Lopez writes that both wolves and humans are social hunters, often seeking the same prey in the same general locations. In such an environment, he concludes, confrontations, were probably inevitable, end quote. To some wolves, we are dangerous. Our presence threatens theirs, but to others, we are also the next opportunity for nourishment. With power comes sacrifice. In Dwellings, Linda Hogan writes of a time not long ago in South Dakota when trappers used strychnine, in the carcasses of animals to kill wolves. As a result, they killed only wolves, but also a group of starving Nakota Indians. The quote, the land once Indian land, grazed by cattle ranchers, were no longer productive for wildlife or food. The people, hungry, were forced to eat meat that had been set out for wolves, and they met the same miserable fate, end quote. The Indian of that land had been promised commodities from the government that never arrived, causing them to scavenge the land and eat the meat that was intended for the wolves. In an attempt to sustain human existence and maintain superiority, we took the lives of our own. Was it worth the sacrifice? She asks a question. The disrespect and disregard for life. In Of Wolves and Men, Barry Lopez tells of the extreme action that went into hunting for sport. There was aerial hunting in which hunters would fly around in helicopters and shoot wolves from the sky. There was also a technique where the hunter would tie a dead animal to a sled to lure in wolves. The ironic thing about this idea of hunting was that oftentimes the wolf would catch up to the sled, trap the hunter, and cause the hunter to hide underneath his sled until the wolves eventually left. In this scenario, the roles become reversed. The hunted becomes the hunter. Barry Lopez's example of the type of styles used to hunt wolves suggests that hunting is not actually a sport. By any means. The concept of doing something for sport interprets that both sides have an equal chance at winning. But wolves in the sports of hunting do not have this chance. If they survive an attack, it is by luck, not because they were given the chance to fairly. By hunting wolves in the extremities that we do, we belittle their existence and turn their death into a victory. An undeserved one at that. And that's the concluding page. Both of wolves and men and dwellings encase vivid examples of the disconnection between human life and animals. Lopez interprets the hunting of wolves as an action that seeks power over animals that contain all the characteristics we wished we held, while Logan interprets wolf hunting as a reflection of the characteristics we already possess but despise. Linda Hogan and Barry Lopez argue that by categorizing wolves as inferior to our own existence, we demean their worthiness of life. I pose this question: who are we to determine which life is worth living? By killing those that threaten us, we ensure our own survival and then purposely become blind to the consequences. What may affect others does not pertain to us until we are directly impacted. Man is a selfish species, a species focused solely on survival and sustainability, just like that of the wolf. Thank you.
These students at Sowell and your work with them are very, very impressive.
comment and questions on the students' work this afternoon?
We should hear it.
Okay, so I'm really presenting because Diane suggested I do so. I wanted to bring my students here, and I said, oh, I have to write a paper too. And I wasn't sure what to write about, but we were reading Barry Lopez's book, Resistance, and there was one chapter that I really related to, the walls of Yogpar, and I liked it because it's about a linguist, and I've spent a fair amount of my career as something of a linguist. And I lived in Yemen in the Peace Corps for a couple of years, and the linguist has an attraction to the desert. And there were a few phrases that gave me impetus, I guess. It got me started on this little project. The word that I saw was the word contact, and I was wondering, well, what does that mean? And it's used very powerfully in Henry David Thoreau's Katahdin, occurs right here in the walls of Yogpar. The linguist says her demand to achieve had for those hours silenced. And really, she's an academic, and academics are very concerned about status. Such relief can only come, I think, from contact with the residue, the local spirits of ancestral humanity. And she meets a man who leads camel journeys across the desert in western China. And he uses another, she says that he relates to the world. Well, there's another word here that occurs in Henry David Thoreau, the word matter. The linguist is describing her friend who was showing her the desert. And she says he was so little committed to the material world. Now, this is the world, I think, which constitutes a kind of false materialism, a lack of consciousness of matter, as Thoreau refers to it. Because there's another sense of it occurs in just the next sentence. He was so little committed to the material world that I didn't doubt that he could have stepped straight into the Takla Makan of 1,000 years ago with no apprehension. Whenever he was alert to his surroundings, a habit my own culture had long since dispensed with in order to move more quickly. So being alert to one's surroundings is another kind of contact with matter, with the living world. So I was thinking, I could cover contact experiences in our different readings, but because of time constraints, I really don't talk very much, except for right now, about Barry Lopez's writing. And I just came up with a simple comparison between Gary Snyder and Thoreau's famous contact scene, which is sometimes called the Burntland scene in Katahdin. Gary Snyder poem, and it's an Ars Poetica poem. It's a poem about how to write poetry, or how just to be creative, I think. In general, I think Thoreau's Katahdin and the Mainwind's trilogy is about the source of creativity. And where does life come from? I think he's always talking about that. So this poem, it comes blundering over me, poetry. Or it comes blundering over the boulders at night. It stays frightened outside the range of my campfire. I go to meet it at the edge of the night. So there's a few things I want to look at. For one thing, it comes to him. It's not something that just comes from his own agency. It's out there in the world. curious guy who says, you know, it's a weird thing about what constitutes knowledge. When, you know, in beginning composition classes, you teach a thesis sentence, make an assertion, what you know. But Gary Snyder says, the world is conscious and it surrounds us. The consciousness is wider than just ourselves. And that's what I think he's trying to say. Agency for poetry comes from beyond. There's another poem that he calls his first poem, the first poem he saved. And I kind of think that every one of his poems goes back to that and tries to recover that poem. It's Paiute Creek. This poem he says he wrote with Jack Kerouac up in the mountains. But I think it's a shadow of this earlier poem, Paiute Creek. And the last lines go, a clear, attentive mind has no meaning, but that which sees is truly seen. No one loves rock, yet we are here. Night chills, a flick in the moonlight, slips into juniper shadow. Back there unseen, cold, proud eyes of cougar or coyote watch me rise and go. So for both these poems, there's a circuit between himself and what is outside. And that's what I think constitutes knowledge, the thing that needs to be said. But there's also that concreteness, which the tradition of imagism is famous for. That is just things. Night chills, boulders, and something out there looking back, another knowledge. Okay, so but mostly I want to talk about Thoreau, and this is an Andy Warhol print of Goethe, and it's a ripoff. But I think that's part of the nature of writing too, that we all rip off things. And Thoreau, I think, imitates Goethe's Italian journey, and he's also imitating, you could say he's living through, in a sense, Alexander Humboldt's travels as well. But in the Italian journey, Goethe, after looking at the works of the painters Nicholas Poussin and Salvatore Rosa, says, I shall never rest until I know that all my ideas are derived not from hearsay or tradition, but from my real living contact with things themselves. Real living contact with things themselves. But he has to look at artwork, he has to look at paintings first in order to see things themselves as contact. And it's that motive of art, it's been mentioned before, the picturesque style that views nature, creates art through valorizing nature above art, really condemning art. It produces art by condemning art and valorizing nature instead. Okay, so here is Frederick Church's Cotopaxi. He followed in the footsteps of Alexander Humboldt and did paintings through the route of the Amazon. Okay, so what I want to talk about here just briefly is the sublime. Probably most of you guys have had, you know, with especially with a little scholarly background, know about what the sublime is. And there are a few notes to it, a few different notes that come from the history of philology, let's say. For one thing, there's Longinus, who views it rhetorically. And he first referred to scenes like this, of great freshets or waterfalls and volcanoes. And it is the speaker's affiliation, or is his attempt to emulate a god who could be said to be placed in different features of the natural world. And Then there's Burke, who is partly responsible for the Gothic, and he associates the sublime with terror. And the greatest terror is death. And we get some of that in Henry David Thoreau. And then there's Kant, and Kant is what's troubling to me. I just want to look at the word contact, and we'll get there in the next couple of slides. There's two sublime scenes, and the first one, he's climbing Mount Katahdin alone. He's left his fellow hikers behind him, and he's climbing over the dwarf pine trees. He thinks bears are staring up from under the pine trees at him, below him, and he calls the mountaintop a cloud factory. It's what creates the whole landscape. Eventually, it creates everything that allows for life in the lowlands. It creates soil. So this is the era of Charles Lyell, the man who inspired Darwin, and who saw change happening everywhere in the landscape. And then he sees in his imagination, he says, the Penobscot goddess Pomola. And she says, what are you doing here? You don't belong here. She says, vast titanic human nature has got him at a disadvantage, caught him alone, pilfers some of his divine faculty. Shouldest thou freeze or starve or shudder thy life away here? Here is no shrine, no altar, nor any access to my ear. And then he says, hey, I'm just Satan, Milton Satan, and I'm just coming through this chaos, this darkness, to get to the light. And she doesn't say anything. We don't know if there's any trouble between them. And really, he's kind of the common interpretation is that he can't take it all in. And that's the Kantian sublime. It's too much for you at first. And then later, he puts it all together. The human mind, according to Kant, will equal even the infinite. And in one sense, this is one of the great steps of the Romantic period of Enlightenment thinking. And it's Kant, but I think that Thoreau is actually anti-Kantian. This here is one of Thoreau's doodles from his journal. They're climbing down the mountain, and then they have a moment of quiet and reprieve, and there's an open area. It's the burnt lands. Probably there's been a lightning strike, and the trees have burned and the grass is growing up. It looks like a farmstead. And I think this is something of an imitation of a Margaret Fuller passage in Journey to the Lakes, where she goes to Illinois, the countryside in Illinois, and there's the vast plains, the prairie. And she says it looks like an estate which has no landlord. So then Thoreau imagines the proprietor angrily asking him why he's there, just like Pomola previously. And he says, I know you're not supposed to read from the slides. Let's see. Here it is. He says, I stand in awe. This is one of my favorite passages, actually, in literature. One of the persons on my dissertation committee said that The Maiden Woods was a secondary work and I shouldn't even work on it. But I like all of Thoreau's secondary, or his journal, better than Walden. And if you're a mountain climber, you probably know about this passage. I stand in awe of my body. This matter to which I am bound has become so strange to me. I fear not ghosts. I fear not spirits, ghosts, of which I am one. That my body might, but I fear bodies. I tremble to meet them. I tremble to meet them. What is this Titan that has possession of me? Talk of mysteries. So I think what's interesting here is that we know that we in our culture, we have this dualism between matter and spirit. And at first, well, for a long time, maybe even still, I thought that he's simply ironically reversing the pattern in order to get back into nature, making matter higher than spirit. But at this time, there was a movement in romantic philosophy, or idealism is what it's called, they were outraged that Kant would propose this thing called the thing in itself, testing on sick. Why even should it be there? And why did he even have to mention it? This thing behind matter, something that you cannot know. And but I think the culture had to say that there was a secret, something unknowable. And I do think that there's value to that. But what in the middle of the 19th century, they were beginning to say, well, how can we reconcile these two? How, this is idealism. How can we get it all? How can we, for Hegel, it was, how can the human spirit progress to understand itself and achieve a true democracy? So that's the broad political aim, but it applied in all different fields for the idealists of the mid-19th century. And I think that's what we're hearing a little bit. He's saying, I think Thoreau was combining those two together. He's saying, matter is, anyway, so infused with spirit, why differentiate them? Well, I'm just guessing about this, but... okay, so here is I gotta flip forward. Here's a John Cage drawing, and John Cage loved Thoreau, and I think it was because Thoreau was a great collector. I think his journals are his greatest work, and John Cage simply collected Thoreau's sketches and made his own artworks. And I guess when I'm thinking about John Cage, I think he's saying the artwork is already there in nature, the compositions are already there in nature, and we just need to hear it. Talk of mysteries, Thoreau goes on, think of our life and nature, daily to be shown matter, to come in contact with it, rocks, trees, wind on our cheeks, the solid earth, the actual world, the common sense, contact, who are we, where are we? I guess one thing I like about this is that these beautiful ontological questions at the very end, and with respect to Barry Lopez, I loved how in his stories and Resistance, they're all open-ended. There's no certainty, but there's a faith in turning things around and seeking knowledge. So what I'm concluding or trying to conclude is that Thoreau is unifying the spirit and the spiritual, the noumenal, and the phenomenal. He says elsewhere in Walden, which he wrote about the same time as he wrote Catan in the same little cabin, Olympus is but the outside of the earth everywhere. So the sublime, the great, the ideal mountain landscape is here. It's everywhere all around us. Chart showing some differences between Thoreau and Snyder. Snyder, we know, is a Buddhist, and the transcendentalists were, at least you can call them orientalists. And so Snyder, as a Buddhist, I think is aiming more to unknow than to know.
Theron, could you stand back?
Oh, okay. Thanks. I wander around. Snyder is aiming to unknow. He's remember, he talks about the shadows, the eyes behind the shadows of cougars or coyotes. that's he's valuing a kind of negative knowledge. For Thoreau, it might be what John Keats called negative capability, which is mystery, but also being comfortable with not knowing things. And wonder implies amazement as well. As far as the sublime, I'm saying that Thoreau is non-Kantian because he doesn't care about the thing in itself. It's there. It's just so imminent. It's right there. It's a part of matter. And Snyder calls himself an animist as well as a Buddhist. So he believes in gods everywhere. In a sense, it's true for Thoreau also. But that's why I think he's Longinian. There's a connection with others for Snyder. There has to be a circuit with the environment that's connecting. Thoreau, I think, is tries to aggrandize things even more to turn it into the sublime. As far as, of course, as a Buddhist, Snyder is going to be, is not going to accept any kind of dualism. But that thing out there is also me. That's how I see Snyder. And for Thoreau, I guess the easy formula for me in the very end, the last thing I'll say, maybe I've only got two more sentences, is it reminds me of that William Carlos Williams phrase, not in ideas, but in things. But then I was thinking, then that reduces it to, reduces Thoreau to William Carlos Williams. And I'd rather reduce William Carlos Williams to Thoreau. Anyway, I think that's pretty much it.
I'm not familiar with the word Longinian. Could you?
Oh, this is Longinus.
Refreshes.
I think he's associated with the Stoics. And that's another thing to look at. I think the Epicureans are value matter over spirit, too. And the Transcendentalists were guided significantly by the Stoics and the Epicureans.
Thank you.
So we had Joey's talk about being in technology, the monkey wrench game, and we had Timmy's terrestrial intelligence, and Alexandra did the ceremony and the poetry. Is that you? Yeah, it was. So these are the people who are here. That's do you want to, like, me stand here and see? Because I know there were questions when you finished, but there's still questions.
Well, I did do my big one for Alexandra, but I did want to ask each of you, actually, because your talks correlated with one another in many ways, but I'd like to know if, hearing one another, each of you sees something that would tie your body of work this morning together, the three of you.
Well, actually, when we were in class and we were reading, because we read like various books, we got to choose what we wanted to write for this presentation and for our final paper. So this presentation is kind of like has our final paper for the class. But each and one of us actually like just grabbed something out of there and we just wrote about it.
And when you heard each other though, did you hear something of your own thinking and work?
I think we did, but like everybody replaced it, yeah. Just that thing.
I just wanted to say that the similarities between the works was probably as a result of it coming from this grass. So that's what
I wouldn't think as much of similarities as a common theme, a common idea that maybe united you over.
Actually, we talk a lot about the books in the class that we like discuss and we like go into it so deep, like we're like, no, it's this.
So, adding to that, we've shared ideas before, way before we started thinking about writing a paper or even presenting one. And like we almost decided we were going to ask Barry Lopez, which I was pumped about meeting, a question in resistance, and we thought about the connection, and that question has been answered, so sorry, you're free to just realize. We thought about the connection between the title resistance and the little fictional essays in between the chapters. And so, well, the class produced most of the main theme for these works. And I think Dwellings from the Northern clearly has been very influential in most of the works.
I was just going to say thanks for being here. It's it's great to have a neighboring university, coming into this conference and to have students from that school getting papers here. And, I hope you come back.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure coming. Lubbock's not too far away, but it's that's a stretch. it's been a pleasure for all of us to come and hear all the ideas and to share our ideas with you guys. You guys ask us questions, but yeah, I think Dr. Francis was notified about this conference before our class even started, so we kind of worked around the entire conference within the course. So, and there's like maybe like 7 of us in the class, so I mean, we're all, sharing ideas and stuff, so that's probably why all of our presentations were sort of similar. Yes, ma'am.
Question for Alexandra. You're from El Paso?
Yes, born and raised.
And that's a very bilingual city.
I'm personally Hispanic. My mom's from Honduras, and my dad's from Mexico.
Great. So you wrote and talked to us about a bilingual poem, so I was just wondering how your own bilingual experience influenced the way that your readings of others work.
Lately, I didn't know this until I started writing for this class that my sentence structure is not that good. So because I write in Spanish with English combined, so it doesn't make sense, but it makes sense in my head, but it doesn't make sense to y'all. So I have to work on that, but like, I really enjoyed her writing, and I love Tony actually gave us the opportunity to like get it translated, which is a really amazing thing to do because we were actually wondering in class, like, what does it mean? I'm like, I don't know, it doesn't get me. But I just really enjoy it. Like,
and just on the topic of language and different sentence structures and combining of languages, Florian Sandua, the 5th chapter of her book, Borderlands, which is titled How to Tame a Wild Tongue, is all about the reflections on different Englishes and different combinations of English and Spanish. She has like at least seven different dialects along the lines of that combination, right? And how she processes her relationship to all of those language combinations. So if you're not familiar with that,
no, I mean, that's crazy. Like, I didn't know all this. You know what I mean? And getting all this information is really great.
That's wonderful. Yeah, thank you for being here.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.